Story number three, then, our final story for this episode, is a little bit nerdy again, but it's important, I think. So this is the latest annual report published by the pensions regulator, and they've looked at defined benefit pension schemes, sometimes called final salary pension schemes, so sponsored by an employer, and instead of a pot of money being built up, you get a promise of a future pension. And these things are becoming increasingly rare. They've been on the decline for quite a long time, but they found that 47% of defined benefit schemes closed to future accrual of benefits in 2020. So nearly half of the existing schemes, the remaining schemes, no longer accrue future benefits for members. And one of the sort of commentators on this said it was a first step towards the employer capping liabilities, reducing costs, and then eventually, ultimately, buying out the liabilities of the scheme. And this is a little bit nerdy. Not many people, I guess, listening to this will have defined benefit pensions. I certainly don't have one. I've never had one in my working life. I'm not sure if you've ever had one, Hannah. No, not benefited from that. It tends to be something that the sort of the older retiring post-war baby boomer generation were benefiting from, particularly in the private sector. There are more of them around in the public sector. So about 30% of public sector or government defined benefit schemes are open to new members. Only about 5% of private sector ones that remain are still open to new members. So they are becoming increasingly rare, but they're the gold standard. They're gold-plated pension funds. They're fantastic. They give you inflation protection. It's a promise of an annual pension rather than you having to, you know, go by the vagaries of the stock market and wonder how much you've got. Did you spot anything in this report that you sort of looked at and thought, my goodness, that's sort of changing the way retirement's going to be in the future?
I wouldn't say one particular stat, but I think all this is just really indicative of the fact that pension saving is becoming more and more about the individual and making sure that you have the plans in place and putting those plans in place rather than being able to rely on an employer. And yeah, I mean, you're incredibly lucky. I think if you're in a private sector DB scheme, there's a reason that, so the FCA, the financial regulator, has essentially said you shouldn't be leaving a DB scheme. And it's really, really hard to do that because they are considered these gold standard pensions. But unfortunately, from an employer's perspective, they are just too expensive.
Yeah.
And so absolutely anybody younger than baby boom, there'll be some Gen X people that have managed to sort of sneak their way into DB pensions. But really, it's more and more on us to do our own saving. And I think this will affect different cohorts of people differently. So for instance, Gen X, you might have got lucky and you might have a DB scheme. Similarly, you might have done a professional job and have been paying into a DC scheme for a while. But if you haven't been on the ball with a pension, which a lot of people aren't, pensions are not a sexy subject that many people think about until they are a little bit older. And by that point, unfortunately, you've really got to start hammering up your payments into your pension, which can be stressful or completely unaffordable, depending on what you're doing. So people in Gen X, I think, could be caught particularly hard by this because they're too old really to benefit from automatic enrollment, but too young really to benefit from a DB scheme. If you're sort of a younger millennial or younger, then you're kind of okay because of automatic enrollment. Although that's, you could definitely make the case that automatic enrollment isn't even enough. You should be paying more into your pension than that. So really this is just more and more about the individual having financial sensibility, I suppose, and knowing a bit more about money. And there should be, I think, more emphasis on teaching people about things like this, because it's not like, I think this is the main danger. I mean, I've spoken to people that are my age and they're my peers, and they are not interested in pensions. In some cases, they're not paying into their pensions. And I only really know about this because of my job. I wouldn't have given my pension a second thought, I don't think, were it not for that. Ultimately, it's just that this is kind of more on us.
Yeah, and one of the stats that came out from that, and I absolutely agree in terms of taking personal responsibility for it and the value of these defined benefit pensions, because they are incredibly valuable. But there was a stat in there which I think might worry a lot of people who have a defined benefit pension, and that was that the deficit, the difference between the assets that these schemes own and the liabilities, the promises they've made, the deficit actually rose by £44.2 billion in the 2019-2020 financial year. So there's now a total deficit, difference between asset and liabilities, of £203.4 billion across these schemes. And that's a lot. Only 16% of the pension schemes, defined benefit pension schemes in the private sector, were fully funded. So they had assets to match their liabilities. And 28%, so nearly a third of these schemes, were less than 80% funded. So there is a big funding gap. And we've spoken before about the Arcadia pension scheme, which was an example of a scheme that the sponsoring employer closed, and the scheme had deficits and it fell onto the pension protection fund. And I think that's the key message here. Don't get too concerned if your defined benefit pension has a liability attached to it, because it's quite common. There is that protection fund in place. And while for younger people that can mean losing, I think, 10% of your pension income in later retirement, at least you don't lose the whole thing. There is a safety net should the absolute worst happen. But the pensions regulator are a regulator of pension funds, as the name suggests. And they look at these funding levels very closely. They make arrangements with individual schemes to make sure the funding is on track to meet liabilities. And of course, that deficit's risen because we've had just an extraordinary year, very low interest rates. A real shock at the time this data is relating to, which was the end of March last year. So stock markets had a bit of a tumble at that point. And these factors all sort of come together to make it look a lot worse than it is. But yeah, if you're in a defined benefit pension, you're very lucky. And I think, yeah, don't take that for granted.
I was actually looking up as well. I thought to myself, okay, well, what is a reasonable size pension for somebody? And okay, so from that, what would in order to have that reasonable lifestyle, what would one have to save? Mm. And this is research from Which. So if you want to be on sort of a salary of £25,000, that £25,000 per year, and this is buying from an annuity, which has kind of fallen out of fashion, but for the sake of this argument, it's kind of an easy to think of that as a salary. You need a pension pot of £262,500. So that's, I mean, that's not a staggering amount. That actually includes the state pension. So that's not just pure savings. That will be, you know, something else as well. But it's still it's quite a lot of money to save up. And it's difficult to save that amount of money, even with things like inflation over time pushing up and compound interest and whatnot. So I think if anyone's listening and they haven't started paying into a pension, you know, just start paying in. It doesn't matter how old you are, just find some extra money and pay it into your pension if you possibly can. I mean, think £25,000 for a salaried person that's paying a mortgage or rent is not much money at all.
No.
And it just terrifies me to think that, and this is an issue actually that's going to hit people like millennials and possibly younger that are struggling to get on that housing ladder. If you've not paid off your mortgage, or if you're still renting or something like that, you really need to have a sizable amount of pension just to be able to cover, to keep the roof over your head.
Yeah.
It's, I think people as well, they think, particularly younger people, older people are wise to this, but the state pension, people think that you can just live off that and that's kind of your right because you paid in your national insurance. And to a certain extent, you're correct. You absolutely have paid in your national insurance, but people don't realize that it's minimal. If you just lived off the state pension, you'd pretty much be in poverty. And if you if you still had a mortgage, I don't know how you'd feed yourself. It's what, £9,000 a year now, the state pension? I mean, how do you live off £9,000 per year if you're paying a mortgage? So please pay into your pensions.
That's a powerful message to finish on, and I will leave it there. I could talk for hours about the importance of starting early and this power of compound interest and returns, but that's probably a topic for another day because it is a slightly in-depth one for this. But the message is, you know, start, as you say, please pay into your pension, particularly if your employer is offering to match your pension contributions. I'm still shocked by the number of people I come across who just let that free money drift away and don't take it, you know, reach out with both hands and grab it because it's so, so valuable. Hannah, thank you for joining us again for this episode of Talking Money. We'll be back next week. But in the meantime, if you enjoy listening to our podcast, please do leave it a rating and review in your favourite podcast player. And if you're watching us on YouTube and you can see our lovely faces, then please do press the like button and make sure you subscribe to the channel too so you don't miss out on any future episodes. But Hannah, thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.